The election. Right there. Here we are. Right there. Right. Right there. This is this bump we were looking at. Then there's a descent into novelty that reaches maximum on the 8th of July. And then there's this very steep and prolonged period of habituation. Now, if we look at the past, see how these numbers have now changed. Now, today is seen to be roughly in resonance with 745 AD. Over here, what this is all about is, in terms of resonance, is the Imperium of Charlemagne. And if you want to pull out more so you can see what we're talking about here, let's pull out a lot more.
So the deeper the...
When it moves down, novelty is increasing, yeah. Uh-huh.
Now, how do you analyze events to determine what their degree of novelty is?
Well, relative to, I mean, you can see that it's like a stock market. The idea is that the maximum amount of novelty will be valued at zero. So that, see over here where it runs down, that's like out into here. Well, it's only going as far as the last date it can calculate, but this is a picture of novelty descending.
Right, cultural change?
How do you measure novelty? In other words, do you measure, say, based on the number of wars or the number of inventions, or what are your criteria?
No, it's like a measure of complexity, which if you know the history of attempting to define complexity, it's pretty fraught. Von Neumann was the first one.
Information,
and then,
essentially, right?
Right, and then theory. Prigozhin had the theory of novelty. Here, let me show you. Let's go from 91 A.D.
So it's based on Shannon's law in some way?
No, it isn't. Because I didn't think that was precise enough. Here's Jan 1. Oh, let's pick a date, just 2000. And I'll show you how it... Have you never seen it put against the historical record?
Yeah.
Well, the basic argument for it is that it works. In other words, if you just had the theory, but the wave didn't seem... So here, see, it fills the screen with... predictions, like it's saying this is an extraordinarily novel date, this is a very novel period in human history, which in fact it is. It's the end of the Dark Ages right there. This Second Crusade here, Black Death, a third of the population of Europe dies. Here's the Italian Renaissance ending in the discovery of the New World. Here's the European Enlightenment ending in the French and American revolutions. All of the 20th century is down in here. And if we even go back further, like for instance, to let's say minus 4,000.
And this fractal pattern repeats itself, of course, infinitely down, right?
Yeah, we can isolate any point here and blow it up and fill the screen. We can look at hundreds of years or just a few days. Okay. Here's from 4000 BC to 2000 AD. let's see, the Great Pyramids were built in about 2790, roughly there. Here's where Homer sang his song. The Greek Renaissance is here. Christ and Caesar Augustus is here. The fall of Rome in 475 is roughly there. And see, what it's showing is that from the fall of Rome onward, there has been this oscillation around a mean. It hasn't been this quality of rapid movement into novelty. Well, then when we can isolate a portion of this, like let's just put the thing there. And oh no, wait a minute. There, see, 241. Now we'll see a blow up from 241 forward to 2000.
And you created this system, or?
Well, I figured out that this algorithm was embedded in the I Ching, and I figured out a way to make it mathematically explicit. Like, for instance, let's say we wanted to study this point up here. Watch this date. And then move over and depress the key and watch this date. So now we've isolated the top of that peak. Mm-hmm. Now it will show us the fractal detail on it. But what's interesting is in all these alignments, it's like I missed the point, but here we are from 1713 to 1736. The idea is, and it's fairly trivial, that Tao or novelty or whatever it is something which is ebbing and flowing, and that it ebbs and flows on many different levels. The 20th century is an extremely novel period. And so is the Greek Renaissance, and so are a number of other times. And then there are periods that are fairly slow going.
So the fractal plays a large... I mean, understanding fractals is basic, it seems like, to understanding this.
Yeah, it certainly helps. I mean, here's a period from 1725. Here's Voltaire's writing here. Then the American Revolution... 1771, so it's happening here. The French Revolution is down here, going here. This is the Franco-Prussian War, the American Civil War. The 20th century begins right there. And all, and Hitler becomes Chancellor of Germany right there. The moon landing is right there. And then everything we've been living through has followed on since then. And then you can go down to very fine detail.
Can I see 1973, December 22nd, please?
Of 1973? Right. Well, here, let's just isolate a little bit of this. All signature is repeating itself. I said up here, Homer sang his song.
Mm-hmm.
If you look here, past. Now we're getting different dates. This is now seen to be the middle 9th century A.D., but for when you go to the future, then it's also seen to be 1967, 68. As far as where 73 is, I think it approached around December, 22nd. But 73 is what we want. There we go. Right in there, somewhere, this area, which you can see there was a steep descent into novelty in April of 73. That's when Kohoutek was first detected. This is Saddam invades Kuwait, which it's an absolute resonance to the birth of Muhammad.
Really?
Wow. Here's the ground war. Here's the Soviet coup d'etat. Here's Bill Clinton winning the election. Right there. And then here we are, right here. Which, if you want to go in and isolate that.
93.
So it's almost like that little bit there where Clinton won the election, and it rises up. It's like when Clinton wins the election, that's the point of absolute novelty at that moment.
Right, at that moment.
And then things go back up to normal again,
right,
so to speak. You know,
and it's always this push-pull
right.
system. It sees the universe as a kind of war between novelty and habit, where as soon as novelty breaks out, like here's the election right there, and here we are right here. And then we've got to endure this, which is a return to business as usual.
Right.
We've been through a pretty chaotic period. The election and its aftermath, then this, and then something happens up here that sets it going again.
But wait a minute, May 8th? The day the earthquake is predicted for May 8th.
Oh, is it?
Gordon Michael Scallion's
work? Yes.
Well, that's a major symmetry break in the wave. It sends the novelty level deeper than it's ever been before.
That would make novelty pretty much, wouldn't it?
Until the 11th.
God, California.
But then look what has what look what's coming. I'll show you. It's fairly discouraging.
July 11 is
let's
going
to change
be
a that to a 97.
I would also like what's this little peak over here is. What's the date over there? Is
okay, we can pick
okay,
it up on the next
fine.
Day. Today, almost today. And then this is this low point of novelty next
wow.
July,
mm-hmm.
and then it sets
wow.
off a real long bummer,
wow.
a bummer which lasts until the symmetry break
that's
is six. March 3, 96.
Sudden drop.
And yeah,
eight.
This is an incredible drop here
ooh.
In the spring of 96.
So, does that
so.
Look like some kind of cataclysm?
It looks to
cultural
me like either could be a revolution
oh,
in China.
Yeah.
It would take it's something which involves some huge percentage of the Earth's population.
If we look at this waveform
what?
And compare it to
96.
Other waveforms, what do we see?
96?
Or is that meaningful?
What do you mean other waveforms?
Well, you showed before
in the past.
To the past.
Oh, well, going to happen. Millions, tens of millions of people are going to die. Huge disruptions to the European economy.
You're talking about this period in our time.
Yeah. Oh,
okay.
I'm sorry. Let's get to the future.
Well, that's fine. But what I was going to say is, so that slide back into novelty may be the end of that period.
It could be the end.
Signaling
of it.
Something.
I think that this is either something like a cure for AIDS or a successful Chinese revolution. Or something completely unexpected. It's steep enough and dramatic enough that if nothing happens, I'd be willing to consider abandoning the theory at that point. Or
yes.
96 is when the nukes
right.
that are planned.
Right, that'll be
the space
the litmus test.
Well,
how long is that taking place? Let's see. It's from
oh, it's only from the 19th of February
very short period of time.
To May
8th.
Wow.
Major impact.
Something.
Major impact.
Yeah.
Now, 96 is when
hey, maybe it's the United States. Maybe the U.S. reconfigures.
Well,
that
it's
would be
something
well,
major.
You know?
It has
yeah.
to be something major.
I could see that happening
like
by that,
that
time. Definitely.
There's 96 is when the nukes
huh?
are supposed to be launched into space. Do you see any relationship there?
Well, see, it doesn't tell you what happens. It only said, because if it could tell you what happens, you'd be looking at an absolute
right.
determinism.
Right.
And if the universe were absolutely determined, then thinking would be meaningless. Because in an absolutely determined universe, you think what you think because you couldn't think anything else. So these people who want to predict the future usually predict too much. It's much easier to say when events will occur
mm-hmm.
than to say what those events will be
mm-hmm.
constituted by.
Mm-hmm.
But see, what makes me so bullish on this is that when you look at the record of the past, we've done so well. When you look at the last couple of thousand years, we've got the major upheavals that characterized world history, at least so far as we know it, and with great accuracy. I mean, here it is. See, here's the Umayyad Caliphates.
Mm-hmm.
Here's the Second Crusade, which was the important one. Here's the Black Death. That's dead on. I mean, I'm rushing through this, but here's the entire Italian Renaissance, and see how it doesn't rebound from this one. This is the era of exploration. It took a couple of centuries to assimilate the implications of discovering the new world. Here's the European Enlightenment, and of course the 20th century seemed to be, and back here there's the fall of Rome. And I'm not really an ancient historian. I don't know what's going on in 328. But
Gnostic Christians are being persecuted by the
Well, yeah, there's a lot of people, but I try to be really specific, you know, and get down on it. And I think that the picture of history that it gives is pretty intuitively correct over all scales. I mean, clearly, you know, there was a symmetry break when Mycenaean pirates took over the Minoan civilization. There was, and since the fall, from the fall of Rome here to, let's say, here, which is the European Enlightenment, there was a kind of simple oscillation over time. And then, with the advent of machine technologies and that sort of thing, they were able to initiate a plunge into novelty that finally fell below the lowest level ever reached before, so that that level achieved by the Umayyads in 955 was finally surpassed in about 1780, and then modernity occurs at a lower level of novelty than any of the rest of this. But anyway, we don't have to spend all our time on that. Falls 9 times an hour, but you don't really know what to do with it because you're cleaning your apartment and driving around, and you don't know what is this stuff in your mind. But what it is it's the resonances going by, and when you have lunch with somebody in Hadrian's hamburger joint, it actually does have a relationship to the Emperor Hadrian. It means that, you know, any moment is a kind of interference pattern created by the moments in the past, many moments in the past. I mean, like this shows you, I think.
So it's like synchronicities, in a sense.
Except that it explains them a different way.
Yeah,
it replaces all that mumbo-jumbo about
mystery.
Synchronicity by saying, you know, this is just the inner penetration of
So
the
on the
past.
Way here, we passed a restaurant called Maya Palinka.
Yes, you passed it at a moment on the short scales when you were probably going through the classic Mayan bump. And if one is sensitive to this, a weird kind of psychedelic associationism begins to spread through reality, and it's no longer seen to be just the product of its own past casuistry, but that it has relationships to the past and the future that are not linear at all, but that are linked through this strange algorithm.
Well, so when it goes linear time.
Could you create a display that constantly changes in real time so I know exactly what's happening to me and I can sort of look at it?
Could I do that?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, we've talked about it as a cable television station where you would just turn on the TV and the wave would be running and with the historical data being displayed along the bottom. Or we've talked about making a chip so that you could wear it on your wrist. And you could see then, aha, let's not sign this contract in 2 minutes. Wait till we go over this bump.
The pen might slip.
Sort of thing.
Now, that would be, that would result, of course, in a feedback loop that would be self-regenerative. What would that mean?
Well, that would probably mean that it, like all myths, was in the act of concressing into truth by drawing language to itself.
So are you saying the act of doing real-time feedback of this wave would in fact create the eschaton?
Not exactly, because the eschaton will come into existence of its own. But what you're doing when you may become conscious of this is you're sort of clearing the static in your personal circuits. Without an idea like this, People are just going to begin to feel progressively more and more bulldozed toward the yawning grave, because the ride is going to get wild. I mean, people think this is the end of the world. This is the garden party before the end of the world. But the end of the world will come, and as we approach it, the chaos, the number of speed bumps, the number of head-snapping reversals from negative to positive are going to become so intense that people will literally think the planet is being shaken to pieces unless they have a metaphor like this. Mm-hmm. See, I mean, the thing, what really lies behind the theory that's radical, even if you don't think the particular mathematical details make sense, is that it's an attack on probability theory. And this is very, very fundamental. I mean, modern science, meaning science since the 16th century, has been entirely dependent on probability theory. And probability theory makes an assumption, which is that time is a non-variable in any equation of description. So, for instance, if you talk to a statistician and you say, we've just flipped a coin 49 times and it's come up heads, what are the odds it will come up heads the 50th time? All statisticians will say the odds are 50-50. The odds are always 50-50. Chance has no memory. They teach you this in Stat 1. Chance has no memory. But if you explain that situation to a gambler and say, we flipped a coin 49 times and it's come up heads, how shall we bet the 50th time? A gambler will say, bet heads. You're clearly on a roll. Well, statisticians don't believe in a roll. So what this is, see, is a holdover from the Greek idea. What the Orthodox idea is, it's a holdover from the Greek idea that has to do with refinement of instruments and so forth and so on. But in fact, it's very hard to explain how this is happening. Another area where this goes on and is never discussed is melting points. The melting point of a crystalline substance is very easily determined, and in fact, tables are published every year of this stuff by Chemical Abstracts. But if you go back and get 100 years worth of Chemical Abstracts, you discover that melting points are getting lower for most substances. And in some cases, over 100 years, the melting point has dropped 3 degrees. And this is, you know, you may think they were doing pretty sloppy chemistry in 1915, but 3 degrees off to publish in international journals that will be standard references for everybody.
Does the speed of light increase with novelty or decrease?
Well, it oscillates.
But overall, the overall tendency is?
I think the overall tendency is for it to slightly increase.
So effectively, we could actually overcome the barrier of traveling to the galaxy if we wait long enough.
Well, see, a lot of questions have not really been asked with any depth. Like, let's take the idea of laws of nature. And some of them are that the speed of light is so-and-so, that Planck's constant has a certain value. There are some non-dimensional constants, too. Well, where were these laws of nature before the universe existed? I mean, what exactly is the ontological status of the speed of light before the existence of the universe? Are we saying that these are eternal laws somehow outside of time and space, like Platonic ideals? Or are we saying that the laws of nature came into existence at the instant of the birth of the Big Bang? Neither of these makes very much philosophical sense when you begin to think about it. It's much more likely that these constants are not constants, and that they are, like everything else in the universe, subject to slow change over time. But then this is very discomforting to the kind of scientific mind reared on Greek rationalism, because they want everything to be referent to something that is eternal and invariant. But since nothing physical or even electromagnetic is, it seems like it's just a sort of naive thinking haunting the very foundations of scientific rationale.
Do the first few seconds of the universe as projected by Hawking correspond to this standard waveform?
Oh yeah, but what this theory says that they don't understand or suppose is that in the same way that in the Big Bang theory you have short epochs at the beginning, you know, eras measured in picoseconds and nanoseconds, what this time wave implies is that there will be a similar collapse of epochs at the end of the universe. And so where I differ from science is they say that the life of the universe can be extended 4, 5, 10 billion years into the future, and then slowly it will all run down into entropic heat death. But when you see how the universe is actually an engine for creating and conserving novelty, then it becomes clear that the emergence of human beings and then the emergence of electronic global culture, these are actually stages in the condensation of complexity out of the universe that herald the final collapse into novelty, and that the reason we can't imagine a future of any great duration is because there actually isn't one. It's this is what this 2012 thing is all about. There is a point around which everything is circling, and as the shorter epochs come into existence, the acceleration toward the omega point becomes more and more rapid, and eventually we will actually meet the thing, you know,
head on.
Head on.
Ready or not.
Ready or not. And most people won't be ready unless ideas like this are promulgated. Mm-hmm. I didn't develop this idea. This is Alfred North Whitehead, who I think is the great unsung philosopher of the West. I mean, you can throw your Sanskrit dictionaries away. And Whitehead had the idea of what he called the cosmic epochs and how the transition from one to another was actually accompanied by changes in natural law. I think you can see the idea, the foolishness of the idea of eternal natural laws when you think about a law like gene segregation. This is a law of biology, that genes will segregate a certain way. Well, where was this law before biology existed? We know there was a period in the life of the when it was abiological. Well, did the law of gene segregation exist then? Are there then in existence right now laws for forms of organization which don't yet exist? I mean, that seems a little far-fetched and sloppy. So rather than imagining the universe as a process under the aegis of a set of eternal laws, it's more like the process generates its own boundary constraints, and it is sort of making, it is literally making up the rules as it goes along.
Can I introduce a level of complexity by asking you, excuse me for a minute, I have to call Billy Idol, and by the way, he's going out to the desert tomorrow if you have any suggestions on his tour, and also, would you be interested in performing? Because I pitched in you as the rave philosopher king.
Well, not tomorrow. But go ahead, call him. There's a phone.
Perhaps in some of his performances it might make sense for you to do an entree or a cameo or something.
It might. I'm still assessing my status as the rave king. I'm not sure.
Philosopher king.
Philosopher.
I think you pretty well set that up once every night. It's a number of maximum novel.
I'm not sure it's a proper role for a hermit book collector.
So Terrence, you're saying then, if I hear you correctly, that we have to, as Jose is saying, we have to get away from this Gregorian calendar, this linear view of time that marches on, and more of a wave idea of time that steps and flows.
Well, it would be nice. I mean, I'm sort of... Sort of.
Oh, that's great. This is exactly it. Thank you. That's it.
I mean, if I'm right about this black hole attractor, then it really doesn't matter what we do, because now we are in the grip of this attractor at such a level of intensity that there's no way we could ever tear free of it, and we're going to be sucked into more and more novel, interconnected, densely complexified domains. See, if this kind of cosmology were correct, then the universe would be half completed only 1 hour and 35 minutes before the end. Because what you have is you have a series of levels, and each level is 64 times larger than the level which follows it. So if you start out, let's say, with a cycle of time 72 billion years long, that's longer than the currently assumed life of the universe, and you divide that by 64, that's 1.3 billion years. That's the epoch of organic life. And if you divide that by 64, I don't know what it is, it's 700 million years or something, and you divide that by 64, and so on, and you divide each successive level by 64, well, by the time you get down to human history, you have a 4,306-year period. That's what we're living in right now. Mm-hmm. But when you divide that by 64, you get 67 years. That began in 1945. It stretches from 1945 to 2012. When you divide that by 64, you get 384 days. Those 384 days will begin sometime in 2011. When you divide that by 64, you get 6 days. That comes in the 6 days preceding December 22nd, 2012. But then the next 13 divisions, which carry you into the realm of Planck's constant, all occur within 1.5 hours of the actual closure point. So in other words, now science says something like this, but they put it at the beginning of the universe. Mm-hmm. And say, you know, that in the first high of 16 to the minus 12 nanoseconds, it went from there. Mm-hmm. And then for another 0.003 of a millisecond, mm-hmm. it was like this, and then it became this.
Right.
I put that kind of compression at the end.
At the end, yeah.
And so when people say, what will happen in 2012, the most honest answer is, it can't be known, because the event lies below the event horizon of rational apprehendability. All we can see is that in the east the sky is streaked with rosy dawn, but knowing what the sunrise will look like. And I think that if I'm right, as we approach, as we get closer to 2012, this compression of novelty will become so overt that it will eventually have to be talked about. Even now, you get people like Jeremy Rifkin and people like that writing books about how time seems to be speeding up. It's still couched in a metaphor. They say, it's as if time was speeding up. It's not as if it's speeding up. It actually is speeding up. And, you know, what we're on a collision course with is the attractor that is responsible for the historical process. I mean, sometimes people object to this theory and say, well, don't you think it's highly unlikely that this 1 in 10 billion years event would happen in our lifetimes? Well, except that the presence of human history itself is the canary in the coal mine. I mean, when monkeys begin to fabricate fissionable material, you may be sure that the transcendental object at the end of time is very nearby, because normally monkeys scratch their ass and eat bananas. So human history is the alarm bell saying, look what is happening. Animal organization is beginning to be so filled with noetic intent that, you know, global technologies are just sprouting like hair. And it will accelerate faster and faster and faster. The two things that you can say about biology and the cosmos is that it advances through a strategy of the conquest of dimensions, and that each phase proceeds more quickly than the phase that it follows. Do you see what I mean?
Yeah.
So that when you draw the curve, it's an involuting spiral. And the presence of the 20th century indicates that we're now into the short epics, epochs, that it's inconceivable to me that you could imagine history continuing for even 1,000 years. It isn't. It's a self-limiting process. I mean, it's like boiling water in a pot. When you've only got an eighth of an inch of water left, clearly the pot is about to boil dry. You can't just assume it will go on forever.
That fits with the Course in Miracles, actually. He talks in the Course in Miracles about a celestial speed-up, and that's why it was brought into existence, to help us with a celestial speed-up.
Well, I mean, I'm not... I think most of these syncretic insights, from Jose to Course in Miracles, to the Seventh-day Adventists, to the fundamentalists in Iran, all of these people are saying what they're saying because they have an intuitive finger to the wind, but it's heavily distorted through the resonances. Because whoever you are, wherever you are, it's incredibly difficult for you to see reality, because your own past resonances crowd in upon it. So I think it's essentially the vindication of all these intuitions, but it will be different from all of them, from the way they expect the end of the world to happen.
What is your expectation?
I mean, of what it will be like?
Is that what you were describing earlier with the sun coming up? Don't see it yet, and there's no way of telling what it's going to be.
Well, you can try and think about it different ways. I mean, from almost complete, almost completely mystical visions of what it would be, which is, you know, that all boundaries would dissolve, that the dead would walk, the boundary between life and death would be obviated, that sort of thing, to stuff like, what if there were a technology of time travel discovered? Well, then you could look at the time wave and see, aha, what it portrays is the end of bondage into time, and that what happens in 2012 is astonishing to those who witness it, but it's nothing more than the advent of an entirely new dimension for human culture. In other words, when writing was invented, the past ceased to exist in quite the same way. It didn't go away. And it may be that if time travel can be discovered, there will be a kind of human civilization established very hard for us to imagine, because the one thing we are used to is having to wait for things to happen, you know.
So it's pointless to try to design starships and things like that to get away from it. In other words, it's going to encompass the whole picture.
I think the Newtonian universe is some kind of a hallucination. I mean, those are basically holes poked in black velvet. There are no distant stars. That's ridiculous. That whole thing is nonsense. The universe is a construct of mind, of the human mind, essentially. And it's now, the agendas of the people who run this planet, it's clear we're not going anywhere. I mean, it would take us till 2012 to return to the moon if we made the decision today. And they're not making the decision today. They're quite making a very different kind of decision. Things like nanotech, it's possible. It's possible. But I have a feeling that it isn't. There's no problem, so consequently trying to solve the problem is inappropriate. In a sense, you know the cliche that ontogeny recapitulates phylogeny, yes. But nobody ever draws the ultimate conclusion from that, because where ontogeny ends is in death, always. Everybody dies, every ant, every bug, every person. And what nature produces most efficiently are extinct species. 95% of all species that have ever lived on this planet are extinct. That's what happens to you if you're a species. So, and we resist this, even the most psychedelic of us. I mean, you get people like Bob Wilson running off freezing and advocating freezing and this sort of thing. It's a clenching, because the real thing, you know, turns your knees to water no matter how loaded you are, because we don't really want to face the fact that we are sojourners here, and that where we're really headed is beyond conceptuality.
Mm-hmm. What evidence do we have for time travel at this point, and how does that relate to UFOs?
Well, I think the evidence for time travel is probably vanishingly small. I have a theory about why that is. I think it's because you can't travel further back in time than the moment of the invention of the first time machine. I mean, it would be like Plains Indians asking, why haven't we seen any Ferraris? Because there are no roads. So, if a time... And what that means is very interesting, you see. If a time machine could be invented, the moment that it works successfully, the first time, time machines will appear from all points in the future, having come back to witness the first successful journey into time. It's as though you could fly your private plane to Kitty Hawk, North Carolina, to witness the Wright Flyer take off. But, and so, in my mushroom trips, I've discussed it with them, this business of time travel. And this is what they say: you can go back in time, but only as far back as the date of the first time machine.
Well, I have an idea for a time machine. Maybe you can brainstorm it with me. Now, if time is a series of resonances, isomorphic correspondences between all levels, then if you had this real-time feedback thing you talked about, your wristwatch thing, but actually taking a step further and creating a virtual reality feedback loop in which you are experiencing multiple futures simultaneously with the present. Okay, so you're sort of cycling through the futures automatically. You're looking at the resonance points and automatically filtering for those resonance points based on an algorithm, then at any given moment you will therefore be experiencing all possible futures. Well, you're not.
Right.
So then one could posit an idea that with this kind of VR feedback loop, you could have the ability to essentially tune into those future points and somehow create a resonance, which in fact would be a time machine. Does that make any sense?
Well, see, the standard objection to time travel is, I'm sure you know this, what's called the grandfather paradox, which is that you go back into time, you kill your grandfather, therefore you don't exist, therefore your grandfather wasn't killed by you, therefore you do exist, but you went back in time and killed your grandfather, therefore you don't exist. So you get this. Now, the way to overcome the grandfather paradox is to understand that time travel isn't what we think it is. Say you had a time machine, untested, but that you knew would work, and you finally, you climb in and you push the button. Now, to avoid the grandfather paradox of having people coming back to witness this first time flight, but stopping off along the way and murdering a relative, you have to realize that what the initiation of time travel will do is it will cause the rest of the future to happen instantly. And that, I think, is what 2012 is about. You compress the entire rest of the future history of the universe into a nanosecond. I call it the God whistle principle. So that if you could move forward into time, all future history would happen instantly. And the most advanced state of intelligence, achievement, consciousness ever achieved in the history of the universe lies one nanosecond beyond pushing the button on the first time machine. There was an interesting parallel to this. I mean, and it's a resonance in my twisted logic. When they tested the first atom bomb at Trinity, they had equations which Fermi was very concerned that the nitrogen in the atmosphere might burn, and they were afraid that they might torch the entire planet by starting a chain reaction, and they had no evidence against this, and their attitude was basically, let her rip. If we're here 5 seconds after, then we know that objection has been overcome. And this would be something similar. I think the search for travel into time will eventually end with somebody pushing a button which will cause the rest of future history to just roll up like a window shade.
Now, the 2012 figure, since you're approaching it as an infinitesimal in a calculus sense, you never really reach 2012 then, right? Because as complexity increases, everything...
Well, this is like, this is an aspect of it. If we think of 2012 as a kind of black hole, then this question, do you reach it, depends actually on who's asking the question. In other words, the relativity of the observer. Think of trying to drive a starship into a black hole. From somebody standing off watching this, they see the starship disappear below the event horizon of the black hole, and then they say they were just sucked in. But from the point of view of the crew of the starship, the last nanosecond of approach is stretched out to infinity, and they fall forever into the black hole. And so, again, this may be what it's like in 2012. From the point of view of an observer, the entire planet disappears into hyperspace. From the point of view of people on the planet, that moment is prolonged to infinity.
So, if time is speeding up, does that mean clocks are slowing down, and therefore you'll never know that what's happening?
Oh, no, I think that people can tell. And that modern life, as I say, Jeremy Rifkin wrote this book about called Time Wars or something like that, about this idea. And I think that there's now talk, even in the physics community, that time seems to be speeding up, that certain data coming out of quantum mechanical work, the only way you can understand it is if time is extenuating itself in some way. People need to read Whitehead, who was, you know, one of the 20th century's best mathematicians, and he actually worked out the implications of these kinds of collapses of the temporal domain.
Well, I think you said something very important, which is that, let's say all this is true, that the time is speeding up, and that 2012, 2013, whatever, is the end of time as we know it. Then, in effect, on a practical level, then it, like you said, it doesn't make any difference. If we change our perception of time or we don't, it's still going to happen, and what do we do in between?
Well, I think the thing to do in between is to educate yourself to these kinds of points of view to be able to help people through their anxiety. Mm-hmm. Because from the Newtonian point of view, it's just going to get crazier and crazier and crazier. Mm-hmm. And, you know, when everywhere is Bosnia, when everywhere is Bombay, when everywhere is Mogadishu, it's going to be too late to spread sweetness and light. So people should be told that, see, it's hard to tell people to prepare for something they can't understand. Mm-hmm. I mean, when we were telling people prepare for Soviet thermonuclear warheads to arrive, people could understand that. Mm-hmm.
That's very good what you're saying there. That's totally aligned with my intuitive feelings that time is going to have a need of a lot of support just on relationship. Relationship is going to be majorly going to be either forced to be connecting or it will be majorly going apart.
No. Well, I think, you know, people such as ourselves and media like Mondo, the only thing we know is revolution, and revolution is a relationship to the past, where you overthrow, you deny, you supersede, you make something obsolete. But the change I feel that's coming in the culture, and this rave culture is definitely part of it, is it's now the revolution is a fact. And so what we have to relate to is not the past, but the future. Not as though it were a blank slate, because it isn't, but that it's an agenda waiting to be read or to be understood. And so our job is to interpret the future now, and it's unnecessary to critique the past. Everybody knows the past failed. And so, and this is what I was talking to you that night in the restaurant about, the returning to the archaic, orienting, realizing that the Big Bang is not only the beginning of the universe, it's also the end of the universe. And somehow we're looping around, and I think we should be entirely oriented towards the future and completely end the old style of revolution through critique of antecedent institutions. I mean, what in the world is the point of criticizing modernism or Marxism or capitalism? Or, I mean, these things are shown to be fallacious just by the act of living the culture.
What's happening with UFOs right now?
You mean, why aren't there any? Or is it building? Or is it falling? Or, well, my notion of what UFOs are is they are scintilla, I call them, but distorted reflections of the transcendental object at the end of time. There's some kind of leakage in the temporal continuum of about 5% or so, and so future events cast reflections back through time. The way to think of it is, you know, those bar balls that they put in clubs that are covered with mirrors that then send light around. Well, if you're a Buddha, a Christ, a Charles Manson, somebody or other, what it means is that you simply were an ordinary person who got zapped by a reflection from the transcendental object. And so then you have to act out your particular take, but it's an angle of regarding the transcendental object. Everybody has their own unique perspective. This is what Leibniz said about the monads, remember? He said they're all exactly alike, but each one has its own unique perspective. And human beings are like that. So what the UFOs are the haunting image of the transcendental object at the end of time being anticipated and attempting to push through. I mean, now we're so close to the transcendental object that all you have to do is close your eyes and dream, take a psychedelic, take a hit on a joint, and it's there. You can see it, you know. And stuff like crop circles and UFOs, and these are simply flexion in the syntactical machinery of reality. I mean, the main thing to understand, see, is that we're imprisoned in some kind of work of art. There are no laws of physics. That's all horseshit. There is no physics. It isn't like that. It's a syntactical structure of some sort. And to the degree that you can deprogram yourself from what you've been taught, you discover then the raw stuff of reality, which can be put together in many, many different ways.
The recent crop circle of the gingerbread man fractal image, in a way, is prescient of your theories, isn't it?
Well, I don't know. I'm pretty harsh on crop circles. I mean, I think it's just malarkey, basically. I don't understand why other people don't think so. I mean, it is so obviously malarkey. I mean, doesn't John Michel think it's a little strange that the telluric message was written within driving distance of his front door? I mean, how far would it have gotten if it had been the wheat fields of Siberia? There's something a little curious about how it is strewn directly in the path of those most likely to be its most willing flax. And, you know, we've gone from being told no human being could do this to, in fact, holding contests where human beings make splendid crop circles. My theory on crop circles is quite simply that it's... because when you go to these crop circles, and actually see what it's like to be there, you see, here's what you see. You see the crop circles, amazing. You see a few ragtag British freaks wandering around scratching their heads, and you see a shitload of Japanese tourists. Well, then when you look at world media, you see that the Japanese media pays an incredible amount of attention to these things. And I think they are a covert operation run by MIDI, the Ministry of Trade and Industry. Quite obviously, this is an experiment in the semiotics of brand recognition. And all over England, there are roving bands of Japanese tourists who, at the snap of a Nikon, rush into the fields, and from a tradition of centuries of ninja stem snapping, they produce these things Johnny Quick, and then put their Nikons back on. And
I don't understand why MIDI would be behind this. What's the benefit of it?
Well, they're studying the Western mind and its relationship to brands, to symbols. These are symbols, is what they're... I mean, people say they're communications. Well, they're a shit-brained form of communication because they don't communicate anything, for God's sake. I mean, what kind of communication is it that doesn't communicate? So, and a number of people have behaved very oddly around the crop circles. I mean, for example, the other thing you see when you go to southern England is... my God, there are RAF bases everywhere, and nuclear weapons bunkers, and cruise missiles, and this, and that. And you're asked to believe that the Ministry of Defense is utterly sanguine about the fact that the airspace of England is being violated night after night by a mysterious agency that is, if you can snap the stem of a wheat stalk, you can throw the switch on a machine. The Ministry of Defense would go crazy if this were real. One theory Rupert and I came up with is, it's called the out on a limb theory, which is it is possible that inside MI5, which is British intelligence, there is a certain amount of concern about the growth of New Age ideas in England. And so the idea is to lure these people out onto a limb, wilder and wilder statements about Gaian messages and the telluric forces of the earth and so forth and so on. And then once every nut in England has signed on to this phenomenon, you just hold a demonstration, bring on your jumpsuited team of crop circle makers and say, we, MI5, we did it. And you people should now all find honest work because your level of credibility is now exposed as basically close to zero. But I like the Japanese idea.
Yeah, that's cool.
And I think the cattle mutilations of a few years ago in the States were also a Japanese project. I mean, it had all the Japanese and American elements. You know, the lonely American prairie with its brooding sense of strong men and lurking evil. And then, you know, the Japanese love of animal mutilation, shiny blades, mysterious padding around. I mean, it's...
That might be a good test of the Star Wars system. The guys are having fun with the joysticks.
Well, people have suggested that, although, again, you would think the wheat fields of Western Siberia would be doing it at Glastonbury doesn't... I mean, England...
They wouldn't get any status and recognition
country.
That way. I mean, they blast England, you know. You get some recognition for it.
The human mind is incredibly perverse, I know, because I have one. And real mysteries can take enormous pressure. Real mysteries, you don't have to believe, you don't have to have been initiated, you don't have to have your aura cleared or your mantras in order. Real mysteries operate, and you get to touch. I always like my favorite story in the gospel is the story of Thomas the Doubter, because remember, he wasn't present when Christ came to the upper room the first time after the crucifixion, and so then Thomas came a couple of days later, and the apostles said to him, they said, the Master was here, he was here, and he said, you guys have been smoking too much of these little brown cigarettes from Lebanon. We saw him crucified. He wasn't here. Well, so then Christ came a second time, and Thomas was present. And he said, unless I put my hand into the wound, I will not believe it. Mm. And so then Christ came the second time, and he said to Thomas, he said, Thomas, come forward. He said, put your hand into the wound. And then he did. And my interpretation of that gospel story is that alone of all the apostles, it was Thomas the Doubter who touched the resurrection body, because he was the only one who had his shit together enough to doubt. Mm. And so if you doubt, they will actually let you put your hand into the wound. If you don't doubt, they will give you any kind of crap and send you happily along your way. So the best attitude towards these things, and it gets rid of the phonies, you know, the telocks of this world, but it doesn't get rid of the real stuff, because the real stuff is real. It's real. And there's enough of it around that you want to have a crap detector that gets you past all the phony baloney. Because, you know, people have been working miracles in the marketplace for millennia. That's just part of what goes on in the marketplace. You know, shell games, levitation, rope tricks, regurgitation of objects. I mean, it's just ho-hum.
Well, what about military disinformation campaigns and UFOs?
Well, I felt years ago, you know, that the cattle mutilation thing was probably a military disinformation campaign. campaign to make flying saucers seem creepy and woo and all that. But the funny thing about all this is that it never comes to a head. Nothing ever happens. I mean, Jacques Vallée in one of his books pointed out that there must be 3,000 UFO encounters a month. Now, this has been going on for 45 years. And nothing, nothing. I mean, the people who wear the funny clothes hold their conferences, the magazines make their money, the lapel pins are cast, but nothing seems to happen. Now, if you compare it to science, it's interesting. Suppose we had some kind of a scientific experiment which involved measuring electrical current running down a wire. And say we had 10,000 meters on the wire, and we shoot the current down the wire, and the meters tell us that the current has an amperage of 1.6 amps. 10,000 meters tell us this within a fluctuation of 3%, but 1 meter says that the amperage is 260. What do you do with this one reading if you're a scientist? You throw it out. Say the meter was broken, obviously. Look, we got 9,999 meters that fluctuated within 1% of the expected value, and 1 meter that was 700,000% off. Broken meter. But now in the UFO phenomenon, we get rid of the 9,999 meters, and we go to the one broken meter, and we say, tell us your story. It's ridiculous. It doesn't make any sense. I mean, I had a UFO encounter, and I paid very, very close attention. Apparently closer attention than anybody has ever paid in that situation. And what I saw amazed me. I mean, I'll tell you the story just briefly. Yeah. Well, I was in the Amazon. And we had been, it's told, this story is told actually in True Hallucinations, and we had been experimenting with all these drugs and things, and finally I noticed that in the southwest there was some kind of activity, and a voice in my head told me, watch here. And so I stayed up all night watching in the southwest and across a lake, and in the morning, about dawn, with a very completely clear sky except for some sort of jungle forest mist on the horizon, about 4:30 in the morning, I saw this thin line of cloud and began to like roll in one place like a pencil rolling in the air, and then it split into two parts, and then each of the two parts split into two parts. So now I was looking at four lens-shaped clouds hanging on the horizon about 3 miles away. And as I watched, they coalesced back into two, then back into one, and then I heard the whee, whee, whee sound of Hollywood science fiction UFOs. And as I watched the thing, it started toward me, and I was completely dumbfounded, and I believed at that moment, and I not only believed, I believed it was going to take me, and my knees went to water, and I just sat down, and as it came toward me, I could see orange light, a ring of orange lights on the outside, a ring of soft blue lights on the underside. It was spinning slowly, it was making the whee, whee, whee sound, and it got nearer and nearer and nearer till I could actually see the rivets on the underside of the thing. And then, in the last moment, before I lost it behind the edge of the hill behind me, I saw that it was the end cap of a 1937 Hoover vacuum cleaner. That it was, in fact, the same end cap that George Adamski had suspended with a nylon thread in his garage and photographed with his Brownie camera to get the three balls, you know, the famous UFO with the three half spheres on the underside.
Yeah,
well, classic. That photograph was later totally debunked. It's as phony as a three-pecker dowel. And I saw it 45 feet in diameter in the skies above the Amazon. And when it was over, you know, I just howled because I realized, you know, this is much more disturbing than a ship from Zeta Reticuli, because this is simultaneously confirmation and disconfirmation. Nobody in their right mind would tell that story, because the story contains within itself the seeds of its own disconfirmation. So there is something which plays with us.
Actually, that's more than you told in True Hallucinations, too. It's interesting.
Do you think it's a manifestation of your own mind, or do you think it's part of external reality, or the same?
You know, somehow we're asking the wrong question here. I talked to John Mack. Do you know who he is? He's the guy at Harvard who's so interested in now the new thing is fetal removal under abduction circumstances, and. I interviewed him in Prague, and he said, you know, I have 1,500 documented cases of women who believe that they had the fetus removed in an abduction situation. And I said, fascinating, John. What kind of physical trauma do these women display? And he said, there's no physical trace whatsoever. And I said, fascinating. What does that imply to you, John? And he said, advanced surgical techniques of which we have no knowledge. And then I realized, you know, I was dealing with a screwball. I mean, what? What it implies to me is 1,500 severely confused women. I just can't make the leap to any other possibility. Yet to him, it meant advanced surgical techniques of which we have no knowledge.
So when you go within, what you find is, do you own that yourself? Do you believe that, you know, that's of your being, or do you believe that?
No, there is something which I like to say, which masquerades as an extraterrestrial invasion in order to not alarm us with the real implications of
what
it is.
What is this mysterious relationship with the other?
Yeah, well, the other can present itself in any way that it wants. You can have this experience on mushrooms. You take mushrooms, and it's whatever it is. It's cheerful, it's this, it's that. But you can stop the action and say, don't do this to me. Show me what you are for yourself. Show me what you are for yourself. And it's just like there's this organ tone and black crepe curtains begin to rise. And after about 30 seconds of that, you say, that's enough, thank you, of what you are for yourself. Let's go back to the dancing mice, the little flying saucer guys, the cheerful assurance of the approaching end of the world. All that. Because, you know, ultimately what you're thrown back on is that you are a monkey. It's nothing to be ashamed of, but on the other hand, it's nothing to write out of the equation either. You're a monkey, for God's sake. And yet you're asking to understand the nature of reality. What would you think of a squirrel that ran around with that as a goal? I mean, you would just think, you know, what? Why don't you just bury nuts, make noise in the trees? Just that there's an immense thrill in understanding. That the thrill is to sort of be in on the joke, just a little bit, just a little bit. And it's so strange to me. Every culture that's ever existed has believed that it had 95% of the story and that the other 5% would arrive within 10 years. And it didn't matter whether they were slitting open oxen and reading livers or building the superconducting super collider. I mean, that is nothing more than reading livers. The idea that, you know, you build an instrument 16 kilometers in circumference to probe the nature of the top quark. I mean, how many people on Earth actually know what the top quark is, for God's sake? I certainly don't. So a bunch of people have marched off into the forest of fishy formula, and they're, you know, hurling shit down on the rest of us because we don't understand, when in fact the whole thing, it's becoming clearer and clearer, is made out of magic.
Well, that would imply that subatomic particles, getting back to the idea of anomaly applied to the physical laws, subatomic particles then must be shifting very rapidly.
Well, I think anything you can't understand probably doesn't exist. I mean, one of the weird things that we do is we have sanctioned ideologies. And, you know, I suppose to somebody milking their cows and spinning wool in the 12th century, Thomas Aquinas was the equivalent of quantum physics. They said, well, good thing these priests are on top of it, because we simple folk can't understand it. Well, so now we have particle physicists and quantum physicists, but even they admit that matter has now become so wacky that the grand enterprise of the conquest of reality through reason has revealed that reason has no place in the domain of reality, that reality itself is not reasonable. Rupert was just describing to me a conference he was at with Dennett, the guy who wrote Consciousness Explained. You probably all know that book. And it should have been called Consciousness Explained Away. But anyway, Dennett was saying, you know, I want to get rid of magical matter in the brain. I just believe the brain is this and that and the other thing. I want to get rid of magical matter. Well, there was a quantum physicist there, Stefan Glashow of Harvard, and he said, well, I've got news for you, John. Quantum physics has turned matter into magical material. So now the whole program of saving reason has to be abandoned. The prosecution of the understanding of nature has pushed us to the point where we see that that matter itself exceeds rational apprehension.
So what does that mean, giving up codifying stuff? I mean,
it means giving up the idea of closure.
Yeah.
That there's not
no conclusions.
No conclusions. I was just at a conference where I met all these people from Ecuador, and there was an anthropologist there. Some of you may know this guy, Sparrow Miller. And he lives with the Huarani in Ecuador. And he told me, he said, the amazing thing about the Huarani is that they don't think anything makes sense. That's their official explanation of the universe, is that nothing makes sense.
That's true to me.
And so they are completely at home with that. Consequently, their contribution to epistemology has been vanishingly small. On the other hand, they have a very good time and are quite comfortable with their wives, children,
animals. In other
words,
they don't understand anything.
Why should we understand? Look at us. We wear penis sheaths and paint ourselves blue. You're asking us?
Terrence, I once heard that you said, and you can confirm or deny this, you said that that aliens were really mushrooms.
Well, this was in my early and simplistic phase. It is interesting to me that, you know, the DNA has only been known since 1950, and already the Human Genome Project is in place. And it seems to me probably if life evolved anywhere in the universe and was self-reflexive, even meaning interested in its own self, that you would get ultimately a picture of DNA. So then that implies an ability to engineer your own shape. And the mushroom begins to look like a designed organism. Because, first of all, mushrooms are primary decomposers. So if you have any kind of Buddhist ethic driving you at all, this is much better even than vegetarianism. It is the karma-free point in the food chain. The only karma-free point in the food chain. And mushrooms, they form these mycelial networks through the soil, which have clamp connections, just like a synapse. Psilocybin is a neurotransmitter. It's 4-phosphoroxyN,N-dimethyltryptamine. Serotonin is 5-hydroxyN,N-dimethyltryptamine. And the mushroom, the actual mushroom that you see, is a fruiting body. It's something basically for sex thrills and sunbathing, but it's not necessary for the mushroom. The mushroom can exist in this diffuse form indefinitely. And spores are clearly designed for survival in the conditions of interstellar space. I mean, when you store mushrooms in liquid nitrogen several hundred degrees below zero, this is like deep space. So it seems to me that the mushroom is either a technological artifact of an advanced civilization, or it is in fact an organism that could have begun as anything, an animal, a colony, an insect, but it designed itself to be that way. If we were to design ourselves, we would come out somewhere like that, I think. I mean, eternal, karmaless, able to exist in many ecosystems and environments, able to go into a crystal form and survive eons. And of course, the great puzzle with psilocybin is the content of the experience, which seems truly other. I mean, not an insight into the human circumstance. That's not what you get when you do it. You get rather a kind of an alien communication. And I think the problem with contacting aliens is to know when you have one in front of you. They're not going to arrive on the south lawn of the White House with suggestions for how to improve the gross industrial output of the Western world. To believe that is as culture-bound as to search the galaxy for a decent Italian restaurant. I mean, it's not going to be there. The game doesn't work like that. I thought in the most recent issue of Mondo, those computer things by what's his name, those look to me, like real aliens. And of course, that's just the product of a computer nerd mind. What would come out of a real alien mind?
Do you still believe that hypercarbolation theory is accurate?
I think it's accurate enough that experiments should be done to try to confirm it. I think you could use acoustical driving to interpolate molecules into DNA.
I thought it was interesting that ESR is driven by microwave frequencies, and therefore that all the planetary signals, in effect, are coupled in some way through ESR to our consciousness, and therefore there may be some direct linkage between all these events that are occurring on the planet and our perceptions or things that are happening.
Well, considering that The Invisible Landscape was written in 1975, it's incredible how little of it requires modification. No discovery since 1975 has tended to make it seem less true, and many things that he predicted that were necessary for it to be true are now secured, considered part of orthodox neurophysiology.
Well, I have a little synchronicity report here for you. Now, that might be it. March 1st, 1971, then a
just reported his experience of buzzing inside his head.
Right.
Very interesting. So today is March the 1st, 1993. And you're surrounded by a swarm cam crew. So we'd be really interested in your feelings about buzzing.
Well, let me let my alter ego finish his statement. No, that's me.
Heidi.
Heidi, does somebody want to pick it up? Who they would much rather jail in order to interpret the culture.
Yeah.
Use the computers running to design the covers, to explain the fashions and the music.
And the reality is a lot of people are making it up as they go along. You know, this whole cyber culture is just evolving. We're just, looking at the unfolding patterns and having fun with them.
Well, it seems where the culture is really driven from is technology. And I'm not an anti-technology person at all. In fact, I'm totally bullish on technology. Giant wasp. And in the Mandaean religion, the wasp is one of the sacred animals of the Mandaeans. The hum is the carrier wave for thought. And when you take, for instance, harmony, you actually hear that hum. Here is this very old being invoked is the bee or the wasp body. So it associates mushrooms with the humming. I think that the real tragedy of the illegality of psychedelics is that we haven't been able to scientifically pursue the chemical nature of thought, and that we haven't a clue really what thought is, how it's generated, how it's modulated. And if we were free to study these things, if careers weren't doomed by an interest in psychedelics, we could get at that.
Say that again. If careers weren't doomed.
If careers weren't doomed by a commitment to psychedelics, psychology and the understanding of the real nature of thought would have made immense strides in the past few years. It's very... The psychedelic
thing. People get interested in psychedelics.
Psychedelics are verboten in the academic community.
Right.
If you're an academic and you state an interest in psychedelics, your tenure is in jeopardy and your colleagues are aghast and you're thought to be a frivolous person and probably a low-D. And, my brother is the only person of his age that I know that has successfully, from the start, been out front psychedelic. People like Rick Strassman, he had to masquerade as a psychologist for years. Dave Nichols at Purdue, how many graduate students did he have to produce in ordinary pharmacological chemistry before he could be out front about his interests in psychedelics?
We heard that there's a buzz that's being laid down on soundtracks and tape and records that are coming out. And that sort of almost like a brainwashing kind of thing. Have you heard anything like this?
I haven't heard. You mean I haven't heard the rumor or the buzz?
You'll never hear the buzz. Just about the rumor.
But I think that the CIA and the KGB, surely these things were studied. We don't know what happened to all that psychedelic research. We know that MK Ultra lasted up until about 1970, and nobody ever asks the question, what happened after what we know about? Mm-hmm. The story they put out was that, it just didn't work out, and it seemed sort of silly, and it was all over the place. But knowing what we know about it, how is this possible?
Have they ever approached you?
Not so far as I could tell.
Mm-hmm. What about awareness of psychoactive frequencies in the audio and visual domains simulate's the right word, but for creating psychedelic states?
I imagine that a lot of this work has been done, and I imagine that it's all classified. I mean, it's 1970, 80, 90, 23 years of black box work with billion-dollar budgets. I mean, who knows what they know? How? And it's interesting that it doesn't show up more. I mean, did they learn anything useful? Are they able to control populations and control imagery? They don't seem greatly smarter than they used to. In other words, for instance, Iran-Contra seemed approximately as stupid as Watergate, which seemed approximately as stupid as earlier shenanigans.
Yeah. So they're not using them, apparently.
They're not increasing their intelligence.
They're not increasing their intelligence, and they don't seem to be learning any tremendously heinous techniques for controlling the rest of us. They do periodically fumble the ball.
And how do you see the rave phenomena fitting into all of this? I mean, how does it...
Well, I think that, you know, the agenda under Thatcher and Reagan of completely gutting the school system has created another generation of self-educated youth, and this is the end of the millennial, end of the millennium youth culture trying to create its own set of values. And there are only essentially two realities to relate to: the reality of consumer fetishism, which is what Madison Avenue is offering, and the underground reality that the Bohemians have been in charge of for 100 years, and that now entirely means drugs, psychedelic drugs. So I think, you know, basically culture has become repressive and toxic, and so people are trying to create their own culture. All these things that go on, I mean, I say this, said this at the rave the other night, everything from body piercing to rave music to psychedelics to non-representational painting to the advancement of the feminist agenda to the bringing out of the gays to, I mean, it's just an endless list, is all part of an archaic revival, that the future is going to be much more like the extremely distant past. And it's not that technology is going to disappear, but technology is going to be much less obtrusive. I mean, I can imagine a world of the future where the entire culture has been shrunk down and downloaded into a pair of black contact lenses that you implant behind your eyelids, and you are naked and you are tattooed and scarified and wearing your penis sheath and so on, but when you close your eyes, there are menus hanging in mental space, and you go into that, and there you have, you know, the complete data culture of the database of the Western mind.
Similar thought to your idea that the mushrooms are engineered perhaps from past culture to pass on information to us.
Yeah, I think that our problem is a failure of imagination, that there are alien traces on this planet, and perhaps alien artifacts, and maybe psychedelic molecules are alien artifacts. I mean, one of the things that I've mentioned to people, and they just think, you know, isn't he a weird guy, but I keep mentioning it, is psilocybin is 4-phosphoryloxy and then DMT. It's the only 4-substituted indole on this planet. What, I mean, if you were to search for an alien artifact at the molecular level, you would look for a molecule that had no near relatives. Well, this is it. Psilocybin is the only 4-substituted indole on this planet.
What does that mean, 4-substituted?
That the that the phosphoryloxy group is attached at the 4 position of the ring. There's no other compound on this planet that has that.
And why is that important?
Well, it indicates it's from outside the terrestrial environment. It came from somewhere else. It was designed. I mean, we can make four substituted indoles in the laboratory, but nature only made one once. And if you talk to evolutionary biologists, one of the ways they talk about an organism is to say that evolutionary success means energetic efficiency. Well, then you look at the psilocybin mushrooms, 15 to 20% of the metabolic energy is going into the production of psilocybin. Well, there are hundreds of species of mushrooms which don't produce psilocybin. Therefore, psilocybin is not something mushrooms have to have. Well, then how could this mushroom have been so evolutionarily successful if it was wasting 20% of its energy producing a completely useless compound of some sort? It isn't produced. The psilocybin is doing
it. It has no survival value for the mushroom.
Yeah, it has no survival value for the mushroom.
Well, the classic thinking in that is that the organism's poison or confuse the people that would harm it, and that's the survival value.
Well, but this is an argument after the fact. What about all the mushrooms that don't do this, you see?
Has there ever been evidence of a specific psilocybin receptor site in the brain?
Well, the psilocybin receptor site in the brain is the serotonin receptor itself, which is the major system that not only we're running on, but all life runs on. You can find serotonin in organisms clear down to the flatworm. And the interesting thing about it is as you ascend the phylogeny, the amount of serotonin increases. Monkeys have more serotonin in them than any other organism, and human beings have more serotonin than any other primate species. Hmm. Clearly, if there were a marker for consciousness, serotonin is it. Well, then psilocybin directly competes with serotonin. And it seems to me that when we understand what memory storage and recall and all this sort of thing actually is, then psilocybin will be seen to be very obviously, it's the equivalent of a radio. It's a nanotechnological radio built by a nanotech, biotech, sophisticated civilization of some sort. And when you turn it on, you know, you don't hear about your own childhood trauma or this and that. You hear, you know, weather reports from Betelgeuse and all the rest of the stuff that's coming through there.
But you're talking about, as far as I can tell, you're talking about doses of mushrooms that are more than just like at a party or something where you all get high on mushrooms. Are you talking about something that where you take mushrooms and you do a specific setting and have a whole
5 dry grams in silent darkness. It's not a dangerous dose level, but it's too much to party on. I think the great one of the problems is that people don't take enough. And, you know, I love raves, but on the other hand, if you take a drug that you want to get rid of, the strategy is vigorous exercise and loud noise. I mean, we all know about people who took too much acid and then chopped a cord of wood and swam in a river to make it go away. Mm-hmm. So it's really weird that the club scene is an environment designed to suppress the content of the psychedelic experience.
Does that mean that people are really trying to get rid of it? And that's what the purpose of the rave is, in a sense?
I think people are very, very afraid of it. And whenever you have a mass movement, you have a huge number of people who want to be hip, but who don't want to pay their dues. And like, look at what's happened to LSD. When I was at the height of my acid taking, anything less than 500 mics meant that you were chicken shit. And people talked about 700, 800, 1,000, and took those amounts. Now, if somebody gives you LSD, it's one of these microdots that's 50.
50 microgram disco doses. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, and if you say to somebody who's handing these out, take 10. Take 10. That'll get you close to 500. They say, oh, you must be some kind of old freak or something, you know. Well, so 50 gamma is not the same drug as 500. And so what is people are being allowed to do is join the club without paying the full amount of dues. I mean, I've met people who say, you know, I'm psychedelic, I know exactly what you're talking about, blah, blah. You say, oh, well, what's your drug history? And you say, well, I took MDMA twice. You say, look, you know, just because you've had a glass of cold water doesn't mean you are now ready to be food editor for the La Russe Gastronomique, my friend. I mean, there's more to it than that, believe me.
Did you ever find evidence that the shamanistic traditions of Tibet, the Bun tradition, actually used the psychedelics in their narrative?
Well, I think that what's underrated in scholarship and in thinking about all that sort of thing is what it's really like to eat massive amounts of hashish.
Oh, yeah.
I mean, I have a book by Dynabisky Vojkovits called The Oracles and Demons of Tibet that shows these Nyingma quaffing down huge cups of hashish liquefied into hot tea. Well, if you're doing umla jumla shit and you're doing it like that, you'll have an experience that is on a par with modern psychedelics. All you have to do is read Fitzhugh Ludlow's accounts of his hashish eating, and it's very clear eating hashish is the LSD of the 19th century or of ancient Tibet.
Have you had any experiences with 5-MeO?
I've smoked it. I don't care for it because even though some people say it's the most amazing and staggering thing that's ever happened to them, I find it a complete yawn. It's exactly like DMT, except there's no pictures, which is like saying radio is just like TV, except slightly different in one way.
No pictures.
So I really, what I wish, if I could have a wish, it would be that there would be an enormous wave of DMT taking, because you can't escape there. You get it confined down, and it is so powerful and so category dissolving that I don't understand why there has never been a wave of DMT taking. I think it's because this is where you get beyond disco, beyond fashion, beyond arm waving and all that, and you just realize, my God, you know, this is profound. I mean, this stuff makes the difference between being dead and being alive almost academic.
I have a question. What do you think of the idea of producing a tape, audio tape, that would involve DMT, T-initiated hyperdimensional molecule you talked about, so that you would create this buzzing sound like Dennis did, where he's... that you talked about in your...
you mean sell the hypercarbolation?
Yeah, right. Actually, create that whole tape and create the whole sound, and then maybe you can do a video around it.
Well, what would be the indemnification problem with this? In other words, if people start checking into mental hospitals all over the land...
Would they?
Good thing you did.
They might.
Why?
Because something about the hypercarbolation thing seems to demand this 21-day long freak out.
As Dennis exhibited. But do you feel there's any...
He'd rather not talk about it, yeah. Of course, he makes his living as a straight chemist.
Yeah. Right.
How would you recommend... I've never had an experience with DMT. I did 5-MeO. How would you... I have no concept of even where...
Come up with 20 kilos, for Christ's fucking sake. What's the problem?
Oh, for the tape, that was not a Mondo 2000.
Yeah, right.
You have any
idea? Right.
What would it mean if people were to use DMT? What effect would that have on raves?
Well, they'd lose consciousness. I mean, they'd
well,
lay down.
I think if you had a kilo of DMT and you sort of actually leaving this dimension... It's a dimensional thing. I mean, you have the conviction when you're there. This is not a drug. This is a place. You know? I mean, because it doesn't affect your mind at all.
No, your mind's totally intact.
Mind is totally intact. Yeah. You're as big a jerk as you were before. Not fuzzed, not up, not euphoric, not shitting with fear. just who you were before. But the world has disappeared and has been replaced by something utterly, not only unexpected, but impossible to have anticipated. You know, something so surprising and so unlikely and so horrifyingly real.
Would you think it has a real value to maybe document something, a journey like that, or video cameras? And
you mean to film somebody doing
the external reality? I've done that a few times.
But all you see is either you see one of three things. You see people lying still and taking it like good men and women, or you see people laughing and squirming, or you see people absolutely terrified out of their mind. And often, when people come down, their report and their presentation are completely different. I mean, I've seen people, some people writhe and say, "Oh no! Oh no! Oh no! No!" And then when it's all over, you say, "Well, you seem to be having a hard time in there." You say, "No, it was wonderful. I'm ready to go again. It was great." So,
would that be enlightening to see, have somebody see himself afterwards, after the journey?
It might be. I shouldn't tell you his last name without his permission,
okay.
But a yogin that I know made a film of himself smoking DMT.
Mm-hmm.
And basically what he proves is, yes, I can do it without screaming. And which is what I always tell people. I say, you know, please do not scream, because it just makes a problem. I mean, if somebody comes to the front door, sometimes I can convince them that we're having sex, but maybe not. If you get too carried away. Virtual reality is a technology for showing each other the contents of our own heads. And I know how I could sit down with a design team and build a DMT trip. It would take months and cost money, but when it was over with, you would be able to drop on the helmet and put on the gloves and do it.
How would you do that? Could you spell that out a little bit more?
Well, for example, you know how I'm always talking about how they show you these objects. Well, one way to design one of these objects is, let's try for a simple one. Let's just take a basic dodecahedron. It has 12 surfaces. So we'll get 12 programmers of the level of genius of Yochiro Kawaguchi, we'll say. Each programmer gets one facet of the dodecahedron, and they're told, you know, design a trip. Then we have to have a massive parallel processing machine to run this, because we're going to run all 12 programs simultaneously, and the dodecahedron will be rotating in space, and as a facet comes by, you'll see that programmer's trip running on that facet.
Right.
But you get 12 at once.
Multiple points of view.
Yeah, well then you pierce
it,
then you morph it to something else, and you begin to... Morphing is interesting. Morphing is what DMT objects do. There wasn't a word for it until the computer came along. But a coffee cup which changes into a telephone, which changes into a mouse, which becomes a wristwatch, which becomes the Hope Diamond.
Analogs to dream logic.
Right, right. And again, like Interval, if I could get them by the throat, you know who I'm talking about? Yeah, Brenda's people, and say, you know, this is what we're going to do, and we're going to spend as much money and as much time as it takes, but we'll produce a world so bizarre where every surface is a doorway into other surfaces.
Well, you've got our total alignment on that, because that's what we've been talking about. I mean, we have no concept of how to do it, but we saw that possibility with virtual reality, that you could take what this technology is presenting us as possibilities, you know, and just have a...
Well, I never got along with Jared or was comfortable enough with him to see what he did with his stuff, but it seemed to me it was always, they were like stagecrafters. They never understood that the idea was to not to produce virtual realities, but to produce virtual hallucinations. Kawaguchi and the guy you featured in this month's Mondo, and there are probably half a dozen other people in the world that good, should then be encouraged to make these things walk in.
Well, I have another idea. Once you hand motions and creating iconic forms that would be related conceptually to the kind of DMT experience you wanted to recreate with the animation, so that eventually, and by process of feedback, and I've been working this idea of a VR environment for self-entrainment, in which you're teach the machine to recreate the mental state, which then in turn recreates the mental state, and what eventually you do is you, by just simply thinking it, you then direct the machine, if that makes sense. So that then David Warner, as it turns out, and Lum Linda has been working on similar lines, so he's got the technology for doing that. So what I do is take his techniques, which is, let's assume this all happens, okay, and then we could create essentially any experience you want. It's the experimental typewriter we already talked about. This, I think we're right at the verge of being able to do that. So I think one then has to say, well, to stimulate enough people to actually create this, what would it take? And probably what it would take would be some kind of socially redeeming value to all of this. So what would that be?
Well, the socially redeeming value is that you actually reconstruct people's expectations of what reality is capable of and capable of being. I mean, you show... See, I really think that the mind is folded into three-dimensional space by evolutionary constraint, and that what happens on psychedelics is that the mind unfolds 4, 5, 6 more dimensions. And the thing is, if DMT weren't so terrifying, you could spend more time in there. But it feels... There is a part of you that is very anxious for it to stop. Now, if you could over and over again reassure yourself that you're not dying and could somehow gain strength, I mean, I think you would actually almost have to train people like astronauts to not freak out in the presence of this stuff. And the reason we went to ayahuasca was because we said, you know, if we could get into the DMT state for an hour rather than 45 seconds, you could really come out with something. But, you know, what we came out with was two careers and a history of psychotic reversal and a universal map of time. And I mean, we're still being propelled outward from the blast of that one encounter, which is there on the other side. Ralph Abraham is the designated remote user for the MPPI machine at Goddard Space Flight. That's the machine that can do what I'm talking about.
Well, explain, what does that machine do?
Massive Parallel Processing Integrated Machine.
Okay.
It's the fastest computer in the world, and it's a parallel processing device.
Right.
So when you describe even this simple program I described to you with the dodecahedrons, everybody says no machinery can run something like that. It would run so slowly, and you want it to run blindingly fast.
Right.
I don't know. I'm going down to Interval this month and to try and pump them up. I don't know what they're doing with their $100 million.
$100 million? Really?
That's how much he gave them.
Who gave them?
What's his name? Gates's partner. Paul Allen.
Oh, wow. Okay. Got it. Interesting.
With that kind of money, you ought to be able to do something worthwhile, you know.
Mm.
Very interesting.
Mm-hmm.
Now, this all ties in with the future of multimedia and the future direction of civilization, doesn't it?
Well, the transcendental object at the end of time is this thing we're trying to image. What we're doing is they're drilling through the mountain toward us, and we're drilling through the mountain toward them. And the idea is that 2012, we meet, and then we then have the fully functioning simulacrum of the transcendental object. And then they say, okay, now step out of the trainer. Here's the real thing, folks. That's basically what the idea is to image. I mean, I see it very clearly. I know exactly how it should behave. I mean, it's flubber for intellectuals, you know. It's a form of matter which behaves like the imagination, and it's the conscious made. It's the unconscious mind made conscious. It's the distant made present. It's the coalescing of human intentionality and technology into an object which, when you finally figure out what it really is, it's the human soul itself, drawn out of the body and hung with bells and whistles and made a technological artifact. I mean, all tools, every chipper, every scraper, everything, is an effort to approximate the ultimate tool. That's why computers are so interesting, because, you know, you set the switches one way, it predicts the weather. You set the switches another way, it plays a good game of chess. Another way, it balances your checkbook. This kind of omni-adaptable technological matrix is what we're moving toward. But we have a long, long way to go. We want to build a perfect mirror for the unconscious. And when we do that, we will discover, you know, who it is that looks out through the monkey eyes and from the monkey body. And it is no monkey trapped inside of us, but the peacock angel of hyperspace that has somehow been lodged in the mere flesh of human beings. And sexuality, certainly. All these things about us that are so peculiar are parts of the puzzle. Our extreme hypersexuality, our extreme obsession with language, our extreme obsession with exteriorized technologies, symbolic activity of all kinds, our appetite for the future. If you could meld all this in the correct proportion, then you would get the peacock angel on time.
Billy Idol has a song that's going to come out in this new album that's going to be released pretty soon. It's called Age of Destruction. And we did a sort of prototype Blendo video for it. And in this song, I got the impression that it was a response to that song in the 60s, I think it was, by Barry McGuire, We're on the Eve of Destruction.
Right.
This one is, now we're at the Age of Destruction. So it's sort of for the 90s, what maybe that song did for the 60s.
Well, or Dylan's song, Desolation Row, is, you know, about looking at the end of history somehow. It's really frustrating to me. I mean, it's so close, and it's a problem of articulation, which is my special department. I mean, if we could articulate it, we could do it. And I feel like the pieces lie around, you know, Mondo, Interval, VR, Nanotech, Psilocybin, the stuff I'm doing, and yet apparently only on its own schedule, only in its own time can it be born. And until then, we're condemned to the dreary fact of being visionaries, which I don't particularly find a comfortable position. I'd rather get it out where people can see it.
It would seem to me that we can even view this 2012 experience as the end of this life, and that we're racing toward it, or we can view it as this mystery that we have no idea what it's going to be. And do you have that experience that we're racing toward it, or is your experience more that you're going to dance toward it?
Well, it can't come fast enough for me. I think each person can approach it on their own terms, that waiting for the end of the world is not the right approach. We should live as though the apocalypse has happened. And then that all becomes moot, you know.
We're on the other side.
Yeah, you're on the other side. And to a degree, we're all doing that. And when you go to places like Camden or south of Market and you see, you know, the density of it. I mean, we just have to get rid of all the straight people and we'll be there. So, and, you know, they are doing us the favor of dying off, but not nearly fast enough. Plus, they have hellish means of perpetuating their own debased kind. This was the mistake made in the 60s. We thought that the momentum of revolution had inevitability, and Richard Nixon proved that what we thought was an unstoppable freight train was to him no more than a mayfly in the path of his own nightmarish dreams, you know.
So what does the current administration look like to you?
Oh, I think it's just a bunch of horseshit. I'm not into it. I think that now we're in the phase where stupid people have to learn that even people of goodwill can't make it work. And when we get that settled, that it doesn't matter how many do-good liberals you put in place, the system itself is totally corrupt. I mean, Clinton's style of please everybody politics is just, it's managed more of the same. I mean, in that sense, I mean, all these problems they want to solve them without discomforting anybody, without raising any hackles. I mean, I was hoping that he would, you know, give his inauguration speech and say, well, now, first of all, you know, I will give to the press the names of 500 individuals who have been placed under arrest, and 100 of these have been executed already for crimes against the people. The rest will be tried shortly and then shot. And, you know, we're going to change this country. And what that means is change this country. It doesn't mean you're going to have to pay 5% more on your income tax. It means, you know, change the country. I don't understand why people are so sanguine. I mean, you know, change comes. You want it Bosnian style? You want it Mogadishu style? Or politicians apparently have no imagination at all. I mean, as far as I can tell, he didn't inhale. And so, you know, just another southern nut cutter is what we have on our hands. Goodwill is not sufficient. Brains, there is no substitute for it. And I don't mean this policy wonk stuff. I mean vision. Mm-hmm. So, and I'm not interested in saving the American social system. It's like trying to save the Catholic Church. Trying to be a good American is like trying to save the Catholic Church. Mm-hmm. You know? Who needs it? Mm-hmm. And why would you want to? You know? I mean, but what's scary is that the future will become more and more chaotic, and eventually there will become a moment where very little can be done. In other words, well, like people are very upset about AIDS. I'm certainly upset about AIDS as well, but malaria and tuberculosis are both raging out of control. And we know how to cure these two diseases. We have drugs. We've had drugs for 35, 40 years that cure malaria and tuberculosis. Well, then why aren't they being cured? Because people are just shit-brained. And too many little brown people have these diseases to make it worth anybody's trouble to cure them. People think an AIDS cure is a holy grail. If we had an AIDS vaccine, it would go to wealthy white people and everybody else would be shit out of luck as usual. So, you know, science is not going to rescue us from ourselves.
So if you had $100 million to create the ultimate VR machine, what would you actually do with it?
Well, I think $100 million is too much. I mean, $10 million with
okay.
$10 million in the background. Probably.
You've got $10 million.
Well, first of all, you hire the most visionary talent, and that means Kawaguchi and what's-his-name. Mm-hmm. You look at the Seagraph libraries, and you call all those people. Then you get the best equipment, and that means MPPI devices like Goddard Space Flight Center and that sort of thing. And then you set a design goal, and you say the preliminary goal is to duplicate the psilocybin flash. not money. Money is not the problem. The problem is imagination. And that the people who have their hands on all these fancy toys haven't a clue. I mean, they use it to design Pepsi commercials and to present Ferraris in more appealing guises, you know. It's about taking the psychedelic experience as making it the centerpiece of the culture. Now, what is the centerpiece of the culture right now? It's something like